So welcome back for the lecture by Maureen Mohren, Exhibition Design. I will briefly introduce her, though maybe there is not that much need for it, as she's professor for system design at the school since 2014. Maureen actually developed the conceptual and spatial setup for Show and Try Again together with me and my colleagues Beatrice von Bismarck, Agnieszka Roguszki, and Benjamin Meyer-Kramer. And it is also, I think, most of your class actually took part in the whole process of developing this week. So, and yeah, thanks again, Maureen, for this very close collaboration, which was totally fruitful for us. So, as it came from a different and maybe on the other side from a similar angle and question. So, to introduce you anyway, formally, so. Maureen Mohren studied graphic design at the Willem de Koning Academy in Rotterdam, and she independently develops corporate designs, books, and print material, especially for cultural institutions such, for example, the Holland Festival, the Mars Center for Contemporary Culture in Maastricht, and the initiative If I Can't Dance, I Don't Want to Be Part of Your Revolution. She's also a designer of artist books, and in 2011 she was one of the exhibiting artists of the Opera Aperta, Lou's work in the Dutch Pavilion at the 54th Venice Biennial. So there she also collaborated with Herman Verkerk, who actually developed with us together in a workshop and with the students also these spatial design setups in the beginning of October. And I think he's a long-term collaborator, I think, of yours. So she is also, let's say, you're the, sorry, kind of mixing up them.
They call me an art director.
Yeah, thank you so much for them. So, at a Neue Institut, they call, as Maureen said, her the art director, and I think it's your practice there of spatial and graphic design you mainly will talk about within your lecture, and which will discuss, of course, the roles of the graphic designer, the spatial designer, maybe also the curator within this whole exhibitionary complex. So, and it's, I think, this practice you're referring to. Yeah? All right.
Thank you. Yeah. Welcome, everybody. Is it on? Does it work? Does it work? Yes. Great. Okay, yes. Welcome. Indeed, my presentation will be a mixture, actually, of quite some elements. And it will be divided between work I did myself, but also indeed my role as an art director, where indeed I'm engaged and I'm actually the one who asks designers, spatial designers, but also graphic designers to play a role in exhibitions for the new institute in Rotterdam, which represent architecture, design and digital culture. Actually, I started with some projects also maybe to show a little bit of a development of my own work, which is also how I moved from maybe print, flat print, or to more also to exhibition design and spatial design, etc. It says construction, exhibition design, graphic design, on display, representation, reality, and the model. I actually will start, if, yes, here it works, to show some examples, also from the past, where, which is a project I did for If I Can't Dance, I Don't Want to Be a Revolution, which is an organization which develops performance art. They give specifically projects or a task to artists actually to develop a performance. Also artists who never did a performance before. And I made a whole identity lots of elements, but in a way, in this case, the printed matter was playing with the idea of performance, but then more the performance of paper. So, which was being presented by actually scanning paper and a kind of folding. So in a way, of course, it's fake, but it represents it. So this was just flat. Here, of course, it was more like the folding, what happens to paper. And here it was more like the way how you can cut it, make holes in it. And this was what happens when you spill water on top of it. So here, of course, it's really about the representation of something which happens, can happen to paper in a way of an action. I really see it as an action. Another element, which is something completely different, it's a little bit going back and forth, it's a little bit chaotic, but I try to, it's not chaotic in my head, but it jumps from one to another. This was actually just the layer for an exhibition in a cultural institute in Maastricht, in the southern part of the Netherlands. It's called Beyond the Amateur, a collective perspective on the history of photography. And it was kind of a classical exhibition, the way how it was designed and set up. But the works which were represented, or actually this collective, was playing with fiction. And I needed to just make actually the exhibition text for it. There was quite some text in it. So what I did was basically on the left, just making very classical signs. And these signs were being positioned on this specific spot, photographed. So on the left, that's the photograph. And that was being printed and then positioned again on this same spot. So it really is almost, it has like an effect, of course, of fiction. And it was really playing with fiction and reality. Like, is this, it's there, and then replacing it on the same spot. Which, of course, was referring to this exhibition, which was also about fiction and reality. It's the same. It's a very beautiful old building. Another project which I did for a long time, it's also quite some time ago, was for the Holland Festival, which is a yearly festival in the Netherlands. It happens in June and it's about performance art. So music, dance, theater, and opera. This was actually the 60th year anniversary of the Holland Festival, and I made garlands out of it. What I tried to show is actually the way what I did with the first assignment, this If I Can't Dance with the representation, the secondly with this layer of putting it in there again. And in this case, I try to make it more like three-dimensional, but three-dimensional on a scanner. So it is cut out, it is really paper, and I've put it on a scanner and then start to color it. So it's very simple, it's of course quite a literal approach of the celebration, but what for me is then important, I'm not actually never afraid to take something literal, but I think it's important the way how you execute it. So what do you do with it? And so I spent quite a lot of time in trying to find the right or a new form for it. That's what I did here. And after that, as a next step, I've made many others before, but this was actually another approach where I went actually from the scanner to photographs. And it also becomes three-dimensional, of really making it a display. The Holland Festival actually asked me to make a new series, because in the past it was much more graphic, and they wanted to have also more text on it than before, because in the past it was only Holland Festival, like here, and the date, nothing else. It looks like something is cut off. I think it's not fully projected. Okay, then maybe I just take away the text. Okay. Yeah, can you solve it? I thought it was only on my screen, but now I see it's also over there. No, but then we take off the text. Zoom out. We need to have more. No, no. We leave it like this.
Okay.
Just get rid of the text.
Oh, no, I think it's okay.
No, it's not okay.
Not okay?
No. It's okay. It's okay, but it's not okay. where was I? So, in the past it was just Holland Festival, solo, and the date. And in this case, okay, I have to move it each time. In this case, actually they wanted to have much more text on it. So it was a little bit different, and they also wanted to have a series for 3 years in a row, which was kind of a family. And what was important for me was they were talking like maybe you can change the color, or maybe you can do this or maybe that, which of course, was not so interesting. And I thought maybe I should make literally a stage, because it's about performance art. So if I make a stage, because each stage is always changing. So I thought it's interesting if we have that, and then it can change all the time. So this was in 2012. This was in 2013. Here, actually, I was relating to, because they had, one of the performance was a circus, but then, of course, not a normal circus, but I thought it was an inspiration for me to come up with these colors. Because in the past I had much more a theme, and in this case it was only the stage, so I thought it was difficult how to relate to it. And this was the last year when I did it, and also when the artistic director left. And this was much more about all the highlights of the last 10 years that we both worked on the Holland Festival. So I thought, okay, maybe I'll just make a mixture of all these different patterns, elements, etc. So in a way, again, this is, like the step to the photograph, to make it more three-dimensional. These are just sketches in advance, which I thought it's, normally in a presentation I always show more, but I think it's interesting to see that it's really made in a three-dimensional way, and not in Photoshop or anything. So it's really an image. So it's, in a way, very clumsy done, but the way how the photograph is made is super sharp. Here again, another 3D situation, which actually followed because of the way how I did the Holland Festival posters. Which was for a Chaumont Graphique in Chaumont, in France. It's a poster festival. And what I did was also something super simple, because it is about posters. So I made these rolls from paper, printed text on it, and again made a picture of it. And then you can see it on the right, how it was being shown in the, on the street. So these are actually works I did as a real graphic designer, of course. But I mean, I hope you can follow a little bit my way of thinking in it. This is actually a project which is really about exhibition design, which indeed I did with Herman Verkerk, who was here. So all the participants of this workshop met him. And it was actually part of this institute Mares, and I did it together with Corinne Datema. It was called Out of Storage. There was the possibility of to use the collection of the Vrak in Calais, there was a big fabric space which was empty, and Mares was able to make a temporary exhibition there. And so it called Out of Storage. And the whole idea actually behind this exhibition was that, in a way, I think it explains it the best, that an entrance is not using in the normal entrance, but you can enter the back of a building. So it's all about what is happening with a collection and what is happening with an exhibition and what is being necessary to make that. So as far as the graphic design, I came up actually with an idea to use only A4 sheets, because these A4 sheets, I think this is what you, when you start to work as a graphic designer, you get all information, you get text, you get images, etc. And in a way, you get a pile of just paper, especially in the past. Maybe nowadays, of course, it's all digital. So I thought maybe it's interesting to only show that. So to show the process before starting to design it. Of course, it was also designed, but with a wing. I think the way how it works with working on exhibitions is also, it's a dialogue between the spatial designer and a graphic designer. And most of the time, I think the spatial designer starts with a proposal, and then as a graphic designer, we respond to it. But in this case, it was actually the opposite, because I had quite fast the idea of this A4s, and he actually took over the idea of the A4 and brought it back to the spatial design. This is this building. So all the actually elements or the furniture which is being designed for it, because the space where the artworks were located, nothing was necessary as a spatial design. But for the bookstore, for the kind of coffee corner, for to announce text, etc., it was necessary. And so Herman actually, he made a really, really big table with these A4 sheets, because we decided not to make a finished catalog, but to make only A4 sheets that people are able to collect their own, or to create their own catalog, which is not being bound, of course. And here you also see it at the tables. So everything is an A4. And really here at the end, so the announcement of things were also being displayed on an A4. Like when you have, when schools are having an open day, schools which have nothing to do with design or art or graphics, then they always print out each word on one page. At least they do that in the Netherlands. I don't know if it's happening here, but... what is also interesting to notice when I was preparing this presentation, also maybe when we continue, is we always have a photographer who shooting all the exhibitions, and he does it, and I think he does it in a good way, but I already asked him a couple of times, please also do the graphic design in a proper way, because it's always from a distance. And When I went through it to look for all these images, not from this project, but more from the recent one, again, I found out, oh, they don't do it. So it's always the space, and then they completely forget to... So here again, this table with the announcements all on A4. And here it is, the invitations, which are also, in a way, very simple. As again, A4 sheets with the staple, which holding it together, which was, of course, all about the kind of non-design. This was the public, the parts also for the publications. We also had specific routes people were able to follow in this, because it was a really huge building. And these routes were done by specific curators who made a selection of different artworks. And then we made these programs and or these programs for these specific routes. And actually, we printed it out as if you print it on a computer, where you can say, okay, yeah, just print all the images at once. So again, not kind of designed. These were the posters. So different A4 sheets next to each other. And this was the space. Which was, of course, yeah, installed in a very classical way. Another project, which I think also relates a lot to, of course, spatial design, and which is a project I participated in, which was the Dutch Pavilion in 2011 for the Venice Biennial. Guus Buijmer, who was also the director of Mares, who, the small space in Maastricht, which also organized the Out of Storage. He was the curator. And this project, I work a lot with Guus Buijmer, and like Herman Verkerk. And I think this project also represents a lot the way of thinking about exhibitions, and also the way how we all think. And maybe that's also the reason why we are working so much together, because indeed, what you've seen in my previous examples, I already take kind of a model how to refer to it. And with exhibitions, I think we do the same. This was a collective project. We see it more as a Gesamtkunstwerk. It was an interesting project, but also a difficult one. And we had different people from all different, with different backgrounds. So there was an artist, an architect, a photographer, me as a graphic designer, another architect, a writer, a landscape architect, and a composer. How to deal with it and how not to make just an exhibition where everybody has his own work. So in this case, actually, it was Guus Buijmer, the curator, who came up with the model of an opera. Opera aperta / loose work, that's the name. This is probably, most of you are familiar with it. This is the Dutch building by Gerrit Rietveld, architect. This was the entrance. And this is maybe the main image of our exhibition. The way how we worked was actually coming up indeed with this model, which was a theater space, because that's in a way what it is representing. And everybody's work, because at the end everybody made their own work, and each work is, yeah, some are more autonomous and others are really integrated or responded to the model of this theater. For instance, there's a work of Barbara Visser. I don't know if you see my pointer, yes. Which is actually the work of she's making a new work out of red, yellow, and blue of Barnett Newman, which is actually an art piece which is owned by the Stedelijk Museum in Amsterdam, and it was being restored, and this was restored in a bad way, and now it's not allowed to represent anymore. So she made a new artwork of it, Who's Afraid of Red, Yellow and Blue. And this piece was being showed in the coulisses, so in the coulisses of the theater. So in this case, it's actually quite unclear, like what is a work and what is not a work, which I think is interesting. Quite some people had problems with it, of course, like to what is it and what are we looking at. It was also the time in the Netherlands of the cultural cut. So, we had a minister of culture who was also somebody who did not know anything about culture, had also no interest in it. And so that was really a bad situation, that there was a huge cut. So in a way, what we also wanted to do is to make a presentation of not showing anything. So the stage is empty. At the back, there is an artwork by Johannes Swartz, which is actually a picture he took at the Rijksmuseum in Amsterdam in the Netherlands with the Night Watch, which is one of the most famous paintings, of course, from Rembrandt. And when it was taken down, the wall looked like this. So what he did, actually, he repainted the specific picture he took. And actually, Barbara Visser also made the stage mirror, and she put on an artwork here, a picture with the text. So the image itself was not on the stage, but it was, you could see it through the mirror. Another intervention I did myself, because in this case, actually, Guus Beume also wanted to treat everybody as equal as possible. And actually, he is also really interested. He's not interested to see to divide it into an artist, a graphic designer. And that was also for him the reason to invite as many disciplines and to combine them together. So he also wanted me to make a work there. But I thought, like, hey, I'm a graphic designer and I'm not an artist, so how do I deal with this and how it's a position? This is actually a little bit of a side story, so I'm thinking, shall I tell it or not? But maybe just, I try to do it quick. So actually, it was like, how do I indeed participate in this project? Of course, as a graphic designer, I'm able to do the catalog, etc. But he said, you can also just not do the catalog and only do an artwork. In the exhibition itself. Anyway, I started to think, and I thought, like, okay, opera, what does it mean? Opera, that's like posters, if I relate it to myself as a graphic designer, so that's posters, that's a program book, it's like advertisements, and blah, blah, blah. But then I thought, it's also reviews, of course, which is not so much related to the graphic designer, but a review is very important for a theater, you know, what do they write about it? And then I thought it's actually kind of interesting because in the Netherlands, probably the same here, it's interesting to see how much people already judge about the pavilion before it's even there. First you have the announcement of the curator, people start to judge. Then you have the announcement of the artists who are involved, people start to judge. So I thought maybe I should do something, maybe I should make actually an invitation, and the invitation as a review. So not designing it, but I thought maybe it's interesting to ask somebody to write a review and send that out as an invitation. Then I thought, like, okay, when I had that idea, I thought that actually could be super nice, but then I realized, okay, maybe we give too much away, and then I started to realize, actually, this idea can fit also in the exhibition space itself. Because this space is the foyer. So I thought maybe these reviews needs to be in the foyer. And so what I did, So this is the work of Barbara Visser with the Barnard Newman. This is the work, sorry. It's the coulisse. Okay, sorry, I was here. So what I did, actually, I asked actually all the participants to bring an element, and I made a picture together with Johannes Swartz. He was the photographer. We created this image, and I gave this image to 6 different writers. A writer who is an art critic for the newspaper, a writer who's a critic for real operas. I ask a writer who's writing operas. So all different kind of voices. And I gave them the picture and I said, please look at this picture if it is an opera and write your review about this opera. So make it alive. So it's of course fiction, but it plays with reality. Because at the end, this is the image. So you could see this image of Johannes Swartz, which was at the back of the stage, but it was also in here. So there was one person who wrote about this image. So in a way, with this review, you see, yeah, you saw that people made up their story, but there were also elements in there they were referring to, which were real. So I thought it was kind of interesting. Of course, it is being shown that it is written on the moment that the biennial is not open. So you could see it is written in advance. So at the end, it was being presented in these light boxes in the foyer. Next to that, we also needed a catalog. And I thought, of course, how to solve this, because we are creating a Gesamtkunstwerk, but at the end, the Gesamtkunstwerk is not done yet. So what to do? And what I did, I made a pop-up. So again, I asked everybody, you know, for these elements, and We created this pop-up. And there was also a text catalog next to it. Okay, het nieuwe instituut, what I was talking about. So architecture, design, digital culture. The first project, again, I was also part as a designer in it. This is the building, which is the project Temporary Fashion Museum. Graphic design done by me for the campaign, not for all the exhibitions. Digital campaign by Moniker. Spatial design by Event Architecture, which is again Herman Verkerk. This was the poster for the Temporary Fashion Museum, where I took the starting point of a naked model, because it's all about clothing. So we have the naked model and placed paper on it, which is actually having the information in there. So I cut out, actually, so I also, because again, I think if you think about the other works I did, it's again about a representation and also showing the construction. I think for me it's important also to show the construction, so I printed it out and then placed these white elements on it with the text and then made again a picture of it. So here you get really the shadows. I don't do so much in Photoshop. Maybe first of all because I'm not good in Photoshop, so that's maybe it's my my limitations of it, but I also see that as a benefit, because then you try to find your own ways, and then you also try to create your own language. With your limitations, I think, can help you to create your own language. So, this was on the building, the naked model being dressed all the time in a different way. Some printed matter. And then next to that, we had the digital campaign, which I asked Moniker to do this, Studio Moniker. And we were sitting together and we thought it might be interesting if this campaign is actually not 100% the same, but coming from the same point of view. So, and the same point of view is the naked model. And I actually did it all with the paper, and they started to fill it in with more an animation and more digital. So they were actually dressing the naked model in Photoshop, and these became, I don't have them here, but online you can see them. They were really not static images, but you could really see how they were, painting actually the model. For the temporary fashion museum, we also used the idea of a model. And in this case, the model for the foyer was the warehouse. So when you enter, you enter the space in more the perfume room or the makeup room. And we did it with perfume. So this was also a space which you entered. And where we asked also somebody to make specifically a new perfume for it. And you can see it in some more images, but Herman used a lot of this foam material in it. And of course I needed to do the graphic layer for it. And it was a little bit like how to work with it. And then actually we came up with the solution of having these loose cards, which could also be sticked in the foam, but also be could placed on glass. This was also in the foyer, where it was really presenting clothing contemporary. I think this was the only place where you could really see contemporary clothing, with a selection by Job van Bennekom, who is the who's responsible for Gentlewoman and Fantastic Man. The building is quite big of the new institute, so we have more rooms, and this is a really big one. And in this space, the idea of the exhibition was collected by, which was about the archive of clothing. So also the graphic design is of course referring to it. The spatial design as well, and the graphic design. So with these numbers, here you see all the boxes with clothing. And in this case, it showed an archive from a woman who really is having a unique, I think she's living in Switzerland, a unique collection of clothing, which is all haute couture, so all specially made for her. And people were able to open the boxes. Of course, not on their own, but together with somebody, one of the hosts who is walking there. So it really was also kind of an interaction, not only showing, but also being able to touch and discover. And this was actually a vintage store, a real vintage store, which was also in the exhibition. So people are allowed also to put things on. And the owner of this vintage store was being present there. This was another part of the exhibition, which was called a speculative history of the Dutch fashion. So it was a little bit of fiction. And for this case, Sandra Kassenaar, because there was written in a whole article throughout the whole exhibition, she made a newspaper, and this newspaper consists out of different fragments. And these fragments were being cut out and then placed in these glass frames. So these were, in a way, the captions with a story next to it. And then people were also able to take home the newspaper. And this was another space in the exhibition, which was called Precious. And this was literally an exhibition out about perfume. And Sandra Kassenaar also did the graphic design for this part. And what she did, actually, she placed on all glass panels, which were being positioned in different spots, of course, the title, but also the logos and also the introduction text. So again, also the graphic design is, of course, really positioned and being responding to the topic itself. And this was another space, which was called Hacked. This was an exhibition, the graphic design and the spatial design done by Experimental Jet Set. Hacked was a project by Alexander van Slobbe and Francisco van Bentum. And what they did, and this is already some years ago, 5 or 6 years ago. No, 15, 4 years ago. What they did, actually, they made a whole collection, Hacked, which is actually taking models from H&M, from COS, and all these kind of brands, and then make it their own again. The whole idea is actually that all these stores are actually copying high fashion designers. So what they did, now actually we're going to use them instead of that they are using us. So it's called Hacked. So it was a store. So Experimental Jet Set really made a store out of it. Fitting rooms. And I think this is with some history. And on the top floor, there's another exhibition which is called Fashion Data. This is about the downside of fashion. The new institute asked Connie Groenewegen to make an installation, and she used fleece material, which is really, really bad for the environment, and made the installation out of it. And there actually was a lot of data in the exhibition itself, and I asked actually, in this case, Rudy Gudier to make the infographics, because these infographics were extremely boring, so we thought, like, how can we make them more interesting and also make it more visible? So he made, these are all representing data. And then within the data, he made images out of it. And that was also being shown on an extra layer. Now, this is part of the installation of Connie, and again, the visuals with the data. These were all projects where I was also represented as a graphic designer myself, but the next ones, I'm actually only in the position of an art director, which is... This exhibition is one by one Stelkamers, which is a period room by Andreas Angelidakis, which is a Greek artist. Maybe one of you know him. And I asked actually Bart de Baat to do the graphic design for it. Because it was about period rooms, he made a design with also elements which are related to period rooms. And actually, because Andreas is an artist and we asked him actually to do interpretations of these period rooms, we decided to not have any captions in the exhibition itself, but to have it all in printed matter. So Bart did the printed matter, and so it was more a folder you took with you and you were able to read. So sometimes the graphic design is very prominent in the exhibition itself, and sometimes it's more like, not really hidden, but more like something to take with you. This is actually one of the original period rooms of, which is actually being kept in the, what is it called, the Amsterdam Museum. So this is owned by the Amsterdam Museum. And what happened during this exhibition, that they slowly started to building this period room. So it was not finished from the beginning on. So this was really in progress. And Andreas Angelidakis, actually, he made more period rooms, but an interpretation of it. So this was the interpretation, of course, with the storage boxes of this real period room. One out of wood. And one out of curtains. Of course, this exhibition is much more about an exhibition which is being done by an artist, and that we ask from a very clear perspective, you know, this period room from the Amsterdam Museum, to respond to it and to give an own interpretation of it. Another exhibition, Finding Keepers, was done by the graphic designer of Sandra Kassena, a spatial design Ira Koers and Roelof Mulder, and the curators is the magazine MacGuffin, Ernst van der Hoeven and Kirsten Algra. I don't know if you're all familiar with the magazine MacGuffin, but this magazine actually is always taking one object as the main topic of their of the whole magazine. So it could be the pant, or it could be the ball, or anything, and they make a whole magazine out of it. This exhibition, Finding Keepers, indeed was done by this magazine. So for the graphic design, again, Sandra Kassenaar, who's also the designer of this magazine, she actually put everything in the form of a magazine. So all the things were being distributed as graphic design is positioned in a magazine. This was the exhibition from above. Finding Keepers is actually an exhibition which shows all different kind of collections of people, personal collections. So it shows the variety, what people used to collect, or not used to, what they are collecting. So there's even one guy who is collecting stairs. So it goes from little things to very big things. And Ira Koers, actually, she made a landscape of all these objects, which you are able to walk through. This is the way how Sandra actually treated the captions in the exhibition, which is done in the form also of a magazine again. So she made this magazine, a layout of the magazine, made the page actually out of, what is it called? This transparent kind of plastic, and put real images in there or real objects, and then placed the text on top of it. Again, here you see all these collections. It was insane. And this was the only space you could enter with some movies. Another project, Speculative Design Archive. The graphic design done by Studio Veronica Ditting, spatial design Roel Huisman with Bart van Meerderode, and they don't want to be called curators. So I didn't know what to write there. So they choose all the items which were in there. Speculative design, these are the posters. And what Vera actually wanted to show is images as finished pieces, or not finished pieces, but as an, just only solo. No, what I forget to say, because what is important about this exhibition is actually to make clear that in the Netherlands we don't have an archive for design. The new institute, they have an archive for architecture, actually the biggest architecture archive from the whole world, but not for design. So this is actually to put on the agenda from the politicians and actually to make them aware that we need an archive for design, because otherwise everything is disappearing. Like, what is being done with all these archives from all these designers? So that's the reason of initiating this exhibition, to put it on the agenda, and actually which they succeeded in, because now they have a budget from the government to start, not this art, but to start researching how it should be done and where it should be done, and to really start the project. But the posters of Veronica, actually, she wanted to show also the process of like what is happening with an archive, so what is being done. So these are the images of stuff in the archive itself, but also as a showcase. The spatial design is actually a kind of a big closet with three floors, and on the top floor you have collections, archive of designers, and they are actually being shown in also maybe a literal way, you know, in boxes or still with plastic surrounded with it. You know, this is from Flisco, so these are all about like patterns, and this is an archive of Studio Lust, graphic designers in the Netherlands, and in this case you were also allowed to open them with the guides next to you. There was always somebody on the floor. So again, this is the archive of Droog Design, which is also a Netherlands design company, or actually not a real company, but they initiated a lot of products with designers, or gave commissions to designers. And these are models from an archive actually from MVRDV, Dutch architects. This is an example of the way how Veronica did the captions, which were very much based on numbers, as an archive is also, of course, based on numbers. I think this is a difficult image to read if you do not understand the space, but so maybe I should go to the other ones. So this is an archive of a digital of V2, it's called. So which was which it's all about digital, which is like with video still very old-fashioned videos. And then, so first floor you have the storage actually of all these archives, and then on the second floor you have a space to do research on these projects. So. So the copy machine is there. But also this is a space where people could really, there was a project actually, they were really working on these tables. And this was the bottom floor, which is actually representing the white cube in a way. So showing really all the objects. So in this case, actually, we choose for the model of kind of literally these three floors of this, what's happening with these products. And again, here, the white cube, but of course not a white cube. This is the last project I'm gonna show. I see that I see what you don't see. This is an exhibition which is on at the moment, which was also being produced for the Milan Design Biennial, and now being shown in the new institute itself. And actually the topic was about that at the moment, especially the Netherlands it's hard to see any stars anymore because we have a 24-hour economy. So because of also all the these glass houses which have so much light, so on all these places, so it's really is about the 24-hour economy. And what does that do also with nature? Because what does it do, you know, if there's all the time light on? So what does it do with also animals, etc.? So, the graphic design was done by Rudy Gugier. Here it says, I see that I see what you don't see. He made a lot of animations, which I'm not having in my presentation, but where the type is changing all the time. So some moments it's super visible, and other moments you cannot read it at all. And it goes to completely white. So here again, I see that, see what you don't see. And next to that, he created actually suns. And this is one of them in a very, again, blurry way, but sometimes super sharp and sometimes super blurry. This is what they did with the windows. And actually, he showed these faces, and all these faces had like holes, and oops, now I forgot a very important image. Because it showed something super nice, because you could see, because there are holes in it, so if you're inside, you see it as a reflection on the floor. Because if there's light coming in, so you really see standing in a dark room, and then having all these sun faces on the floor. So it was a super simple little idea, but it's interesting to see that it has a lot of impact in the exhibition space, which I think now the exhibition can handle it, but I can also imagine if it's a different type of exhibition, then it can also be super annoying. But in this case, it really worked. This is the presentation in the new institute itself, and not from Milan. Olivier Goethals, he did the spatial design. He's actually also trained as an architect. And what he did, actually, he copied exactly the space which we had in Milan. So it's again a representation of a representation. So I think if you notice, with many of the people we work, or if you see it in my work or people we work with, it all is kind of dealing with similar approaches, but on a different way. So this black box is actually the space which we used to have in Milan. This is the entrance. And the model of this exhibition was the idea of an, and now I forgot the whole name, these old-fashioned also with the images going all the way around. And I forgot the name. Stupid. Who can help me? Panorama, sorry. Stupid. So the whole idea was indeed to create a panorama. And because the artworks were mainly, or actually only, digital. So video or slideshows. So it was all about projection. And this panorama consists out of two layers. So it was the layer of the artworks, which were holes in there. And then there's the layer of the panorama itself, in a way, which was done by Rudy with all different kind of information from the research department about, with a lot of data also about this economy and about the influence on nature, and so it's also about how much sleep do you get, etc. So yeah, and this was a reference because it all came from a project from Aldo van Eyck, which they took at a starting point, and this was actually a reference to it. And the last image is indeed this presentation of this project of Aldo van Eyck. So actually, in these cases, my role indeed is that I'm the one actually who start to talk first, you know, with the people who are making this project. It could be a researcher. We work a lot with researchers and not so much with curators, but it could also be a curator. And then we, of course, start to talk about what kind of exhibition should it be, and what do we need, what kind of people. And then I'm the one who start to think, who to ask, and guide these projects. And so with the spatial designer, but with also the graphic designer. I never did a spatial design myself, but of course, being more and more involved in it, because my role is a little bit, in a way, I'm an art director, but I also make things myself. So I have, sometimes I'm sitting, you know, behind a computer and doing it, and sometimes I'm really directing it. Yeah, I think that this is it. So it's a bit fragmented, sorry.
Thank you very much for this talk. And I find it pretty striking that we kind of started with the stages in your graphic design in the beginning with the Holland Festival, and kind of end with some other kinds of stages, so within the exhibition and the new institute. So I think this is maybe already something we can kind of discuss. So because you were starting actually as a graphic designer, maybe already creating space and already creating some kind of environments, and now as a art director at the new institute, of course you're kind of in the same place, but of course with a whole crowd of collaborators to work on that. And maybe to elaborate a little bit more on that, we could visit back your practice as a graphic designer, because of course taking things literally mm-hmm. allows to reflect so on like on a very reflexive level on the whole structure of what you're working on. So when you, for example, address performance and then use the performance of the paper and mm-hmm. so on and so on. Mm-hmm. So was it also that these, let's say, projects you did as a graphic designer feed back into the project itself? So was it a very close collaboration also with the directors of the Holland Festival or with If I Can't Dance and so on? I mean, maybe it was already at that point, only that it was, yeah, let's say the outcome was on paper, but it was already in discussion with the people who were in charge for the mm-hmm. actually, let's say, exhibition or mm-hmm. festival. So,
yeah, I think many projects are in very close collaborationship. But for instance, with the Holland Festival, that I mean, my posters had no influence on the program, because this program is of course being produced a long time in advance. So as soon as they have the program, they come to me. But it was a longer project for 10 years. And so in a way, I had, it was not really close, but I had a lot of freedom. So there was a lot of trust of the artistic director. So yeah, in a way, I could do what I thought was necessary. But it had no influence. But for instance, with the Out of Storage, I think that you could see. I mean, but then it's again a dialogue with the spatial designer. So it also had not really influence on the program itself. Maybe actually now I have more influence on my position of content and of, you know, like what we want to show and who we want to work with than in as the role of a graphic designer. Although they ask me quite early, and I think we do also now the same within my position. We also ask the graphic designer in an early stage. So maybe actually I think in the case of this project, I think Rudy also had quite some influence. So. Yeah, is that?
I mean, it always depends on how you understand influence. With Out of Storage, of course, like the whole room mm-hmm. was structured according to how you actually were conceptualizing yeah. mm-hmm. the space. So, and it was reflecting mm-hmm. upon the topic itself. So, of course, this is quite influential, or mm-hmm. let's say it makes the whole exhibition. Yeah. So, and adds this second layer. So, mm-hmm. of course, there were a lot of slices.
Yeah, sorry,
I just realized
I thought, like,
now.
I'd go back
no,
then.
It was amazing to like really browse through. through the so your practice, because it really felt like a developing program, and it totally makes sense
that's at least what I try to that's of course also decisions for these mm-hmm. works, of course also indeed to show these stages and to show I also realized, because actually I never really gave a presentation about my role as an art director. Mm-hmm. And I also never really talk about, I think it's much more difficult also mm-hmm. to talk about projects other people did. For me, it's more easy to talk about my own designs mm-hmm. in a way. Mm-hmm. So, but now indeed I thought like, okay, how to, because I'm also really a maker. Mm-hmm. So in the sense of, sometimes that's also a little bit difficult. That I also feel, or maybe it helps and maybe sometimes it doesn't help, because if you know, I look at, but maybe it's the same actually also with students, when which you need to guide. Mm-hmm. But then you need to guide professionals. Mm-hmm. Yeah? So with students maybe, you know that they need your expertise, that's why they're here for. But with professionals, sometimes it's also much more difficult, like which position do I'm gonna take? Am I now directing it? Do I, because I really want it? And I think it also varies a bit if they are young or if they are, you know, like experimental jet set. It's my generation. So, and their voice is so strong, so it doesn't make sense. And actually then I also feel like, go ahead, you know. If you ask them, I know what they do. And you also know more or less what you get, so.
So these forms of collaboration, they always differ also from the people you're working with, how open they are for any kind of, let's say, interference also from your side.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah, that's also really interesting because now, actually, we have an exhibition which opens this Saturday and the topic is really, really great. It's about the hoodie and it's about who has the right to wear one because it's the hoodie, which it depends like who you are, where you walk, if you are allowed to, or if you're if you're already suspicious, or what is it like? Anyway, so it's a really interesting topic, and but in this case, so maybe it's also interesting to talk about that. We are working with the curator. The curator came to the new institute. I think we explained it. Like also my role, because it's not so common to have a role like this at an institute. It almost doesn't happen. So, actually I propose to work with a completely different type of other people, Bless, I don't know if you know them. They come from, of course, the fashion world. I'm not allowed to say fashion designers. But I thought it was interesting because they also think so much about representation. So their shop is not a shop, it's an apartment. So everything, there are really people living there. So if you go to their store, you're entering a house. So they put everything in a specific environment. And so I asked them and they were really interested. But in this case, it was quite difficult because the curator already selected artworks. And she was a little bit afraid of the way how Bless wanted to present the artworks. And and Bless said, let's just ask the artist, you know, if it's allowed or not allowed, because they didn't want to make a white cube with only objects. Of course, that's also the reason why I asked them. We also do not want to make a white cube with artworks. But, and they were actually very extreme in the sense like, okay, it's either you take the whole concept and we're not going to make exceptions. And she couldn't handle. So that was that was quite tough. So actually we stopped the collaboration. And I thought, okay, we will do another project with them, and we will. So, but then in this case now, the curator really see that she has a problem, and I also see that she is not really ready for. She is not really ready also to follow the way how we approach it, because the exhibitions we do are not white cubes, because it's also not about art. So very often it's about a story, which actually we want to tell. And then, so it's, you know, here at the MDBK, for instance, or whatever, it's clear. It's just white cubes with artworks, and which is completely fine, and nothing wrong with that. But that doesn't work neither in our spaces, nor with the topics, or what is being told. So also the hoodie. The hoodie is not an artwork. So how to deal with that? And now actually it becomes, sadly enough, don't put it online.
I'm really sorry that I haven't chosen the hoodie this morning, really.
So it is...
it was in question.
No, it is, so it will, it will be, I think at the end it will be, every piece will be presented as an artwork. Well, I think it's not an artwork. Mm-hmm. So this was a really a tough project.
A Quite interesting, and it directly points to this fact. So, but exactly. Maybe there are some other questions in the audience.
Yeah, thank you so much. That was really wonderful, a tour de force through a lot of image material. I'm wondering, linking back exactly to the discussion that you just started, would you say that what you do is curatorial work as an art director? Because I think it's really interesting to follow the lines of conflict apparently existing between different instances in which design of the situation takes place. Just the one that you described, where you would be responsible for it on the one hand, the curators claim to be responsible on the other, and Bless would be a third position claiming responsibility for a certain setup. Yeah. In terms of, it's not just spatial design, it's almost more than that. That would be one part of my question. What would you consider to be the difference between an art director and a curator? And where does that difference start? And the other question would be, how does your position as an art director influence your thinking as a graphic designer?
The first question, yes, I do think indeed it is also, maybe I'm not even doing it, but if I ask, for instance, Bless, then they didn't do it, but of course if they would have done it, it would have been very dominant. That was also one of the difficulties from the curator, where she said, like, I don't want to be in the world of Bless, you know? And I think, yeah, but then, indeed, that's then, you could also see it as a work, but it doesn't mean that they would not treat respectful and in dialogue with everybody how to present. She would, for instance, they actually wanted to they proposed actually to not have a big screen, but then maybe to have an iPad in that somebody's having it in his hand, like one of the dolls who's also wearing a hoodie. So that's the difference. So in a way, the work is still the same, but it's not solo, you know, in a white environment. So indeed, in that sense, it is also choosing them also leads to a different direction. And also the idea actually of a model, because the model itself already communicates something. But I would, of course, never do that when you think, okay, it doesn't fit it. So it really depends on what is the story. And so is there a bigger story? And then the second question was, I forgot it already.
How does this position of the art director influence or have kind of repercussions on whatever you do as a graphic designer?
I don't think so, actually. No, the only thing is that maybe I'm more aware of my position on the table, that in the past, you know, when I presented my work and somebody who was sitting on the other side of the table, and now, of course, there are also people who present their work to me. So maybe I'm more aware of that, for instance, that I think it's also good to take a little bit of time. So also not to expect that somebody has to respond immediately and to be able to go to the next step. So this is what maybe changed myself, but not so much on my own work. So I mean, of course, I see a difference with the work I did in the past and the work I do now. But I think that's not because of. So I maybe see more clear where my role is when I can do something, when I can experiment, and when it's not necessary to experiment, or when you should not experiment. You know, when you just have to deliver something. But this is something, of course, which is developing through the years and which has nothing so much to do with my role.
Can you say, concerning your graphic design itself, if there is inspiration from where you took, you know, certain ideas? For example, I feel like there is reappearing elements aesthetically that I could see in different works. For example, the element of the archive, you know, is that something that you would consider, like, I don't know,
where do I get my inspiration from?
Yes, exactly.
That's what you're saying. The archive is not so much to me personally. That's more, you know, the topics which are coming back at the New Institute, because also they have like a big archive. And so it's in their program a lot. But I don't know, I take my inspiration from very daily objects. And so also for me, for instance, I mean, it's not in my presentation now, but the newspaper is also something which I really like and do a lot with. But for instance, you know, indeed with the stage of the Holland Festival, it's also literally a stage. So I'm never afraid indeed to react to maybe the content of the topic, and then start from there. I also say to my students a lot, there, you know, you can, if you have an idea, a clear idea, then you start here, and I said it's always easier to go from this clear idea this way than when you start here. So you do not know actually what you really want to do, or you do not have a clear idea, and you do not have a reference or whatever to go here. It's much more difficult. So in a way, you can also compare it with a book. I think you always need a grid. And the grid is also there to be able to escape. Because if you don't have a grid, you also cannot escape. So, for me, again, also choosing a literal ID, that also means I have the literal ID, but I can still get rid of it, you know, not treating it in a literal way. So I try to, get away from it, but at least I know the starting point is clear. And that's, for me personally, very important. Because otherwise, I don't know what I'm doing. Why am I doing this? And why is this good? Or why is it bad? And does it tell the story I want to say? And if I have a clear idea, then I can relate to it. Yeah, I think my students hate me at the moment because I'm repeating myself so much. It's always the same thing over and over because it's, I think they can make funny jokes probably. So maybe they do. So I don't know, maybe it really is daily life. But also, I mean, I never get any inspiration of graphic design itself. So I never buy graphic design books. So for me, for instance, one of my heroes who I also really got inspired by is Marta Margiela. Not now anymore, of course. He's not producing work, so it comes indeed from fashion. But it also comes from you know, like architecture, but it also comes from, you know, the things we know, like the book notes or note blocks or newspapers or things which are existing. Maybe they even inspire me more. It's that I just like kind of to, maybe it doesn't show it now in this presentation, but.
Hi, here.
Yeah.
So I would be interested to know a bit more about your approach, or maybe what differs in your approach or practice if you, depending on if you work with objects and maybe cultural historical objects, or with art objects and then maybe artists are coming with that. So if it makes a difference in your approach, and you said that it's a lot about the story you want to tell, and it all depends on the story. So my question would be, what is the status of the object, be it art object?
I think that really varies, because also I've made like artist books, you know, who are, then the image has to be the image. So, I'm just referring to the story that within the New Institute, many of these exhibitions are about stories they want to tell. So within, for instance, the speculative design archive, it really speculative design archive, it really is about showing these archives, and it's not about one product specifically. But I don't know how to answer this. I mean, I also do more books or things. I mean, we also do sometimes exhibitions which just need, in a classical way, captions. And that's also possible. We still want maybe to do it with a twist, but then to treat it like what is necessary. So it really depends. Now, of course, these are very much about the projects I showed now, the Holland Festival is a poster. With posters, I think you have to make images. I don't know. I mean, it really varies. So the object for me is depending on what the project is. It really depends. I can't give like a very clear answer, but it's more, I mean, if I would show more of my work, you probably will understand and see the difference. Now maybe all the things are quite visual, and also the exhibitions are exhibitions, and they all indeed are models. And of course, I choose them now on purpose, because indeed, like what Julia was saying, I did it, of course, on purpose to show the reference of this stage at the Holland Festival towards the an exhibition, etc. But yeah, I mean, a book of mine could also be here, and then maybe it's. Sorry that I'm just not able to answer it in a really good way. Time are we leaving it? Yeah, I think it's time for a break. Okay.
Well, thank you so much, Maureen.
Thank you all
for this talk, and thank you for your questions. And who of you who haven't seen the second floor of the gallery, there is a second part of this spatial installation. Have a look in the break, and we'll meet back here at 6 p.m. for the talk with Thomas Vesky, the invisible part of the iceberg. And hope to see you there. So, see you later.
Thank you. Thank you.